isn't the biological father. Maybe they thought, well, they have to justify it with both. I'm not sure exactly why. Getting back to the Isaiah prophecy, which is a very, very important prophecy, and I have to apologize. It's
25 names, please.
I have already dealt with that. But let me finish my answer.
That
there are two different genealogies being presented there.
Okay.
The genealogy of... Well, let me finish responding to some of the other things.
I thought you changed the subject. That's why I'm sorry.
I want... Well, I am. There's so many subjects. I've got to change subjects. I don't know who you're clapping for, but I'll just take it personally that you're clapping for me.
but you did in 1 hour what I didn't do here.
Getting back to Isaiah now, because that's a very, very important prophecy, and I think Yosef raised some very important challenges, and the one regret I have regarding them is that there are a lot of details involved, and I don't know how well you're able to follow it. But one of the where do I start? Let me start with Emmanuel. You know, is Emmanuel merely a name or a description of who this person is? God with us. Now, there are a lot of ways to answer that question. One way is to show the so many prophecies in Scripture. So many prophecies that talk about Messiah actually being, I don't know how you say it, Yahweh, Adonai, not Adonai. But for instance, from Jeremiah 23, 5, especially 6, it talks about a child being born, a branch of David. So everybody knows that we're talking about the Messiah here. And then it says, you know what his name is going to be? His name is going to be God, and that's the Yud, He, Vav, He. God, our righteousness. That's incredible. What that's saying is Messiah is going to be Yahweh. And beyond that, it's also saying that Messiah is going to be, as the New Testament has said in so many ways, and also, I would add the Tanakh, that our righteousness, if we are going to come before God, it can never be in our own righteousness. It has to be in the righteousness that is given as a gift by God. And so it says about this child, who is the branch of David, it says about him that he is going to be God, our righteousness, because we cannot have confidence in our own righteousness. Because if we're really honest with ourselves and we look at ourselves, we know how far short of God that we fall. And so we know that there has to be an offering. But not like the offerings that were made traditionally in the temple, offerings that had to be offered over and over again. It would have to be the Messiah himself who would be offered as a covenant, a once and for all offering, the very offering that all Israel has been waiting for, the very offering that would make us righteous in God's sight. But let's go back to the context, because I think the context is the most important thing. And as I mentioned before, if you're going to understand Isaiah 7, it's related to Isaiah 8 and 9 and 10 and 11, because what Isaiah does in these chapters is continues to return to the same theme. Talks about a child being born. For instance, in Isaiah 9. Let me just read you Isaiah 9, 6 to 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name, here's his name again, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor. I think it's Peleoax, a word that only pertains to God. Mighty God, in other words, El Gibor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, and upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from this time forward and even forever. What that's saying is, and it's something that we agree with the rabbis, that this is talking about Messiah. It's talking about that branch that's going to come from David. But here, notice, he's called four names, four additional names. And these aren't just names like Daniel or Nathaniel or Emmanuel. These are descriptions of who the person is, because you got four lengthy descriptions which go along with Emmanuel. Here Isaiah is giving us an expanded picture of who this child is who is going to be born. And so one of the names, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, can these be names like David or John or Nathan? Or no, these are descriptions of who Messiah is going to be. And then if you look at Isaiah 11, Isaiah again, for the third time in his book and the only time, talks about a coming of a child. And so however we understand Emmanuel and Alma, it must be consistent with these other contexts. Now here's Isaiah 11. There shall come forth a root from the stem of Jesse. Again, we know that we're talking about Messiah, right? And a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge. And it talks about this everlasting kingdom coming from the root of Jesse. Again, everybody agrees we're looking at the Messiah. And here again, this child is born. I would assert that responsible principles of interpretation require that we understand these three immediate contexts in the same light. As we look at Isaiah 7:14 about a virgin who's going to give birth to a child, we have to understand this child as a messianic king. Why do we understand as a messianic king? Because chapter 9 is talking about a child being born who's a messianic king. And chapter 11 talks about a child being born who's the messianic king. Now, Rabbi Yosef talked about the fact, well, this prophecy was made 700 years earlier, and it seems to have been made to King Ahaz. And yes, it was, but I would argue, if you look carefully at the language, you'll see that not only was it made to King Ahaz, but it was made to the whole household of Israel, or the household of David. So let's go back to 7:10. And it says, moreover, the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, ask for a sign for yourself, the Lord your God. Ask it either in the depth or the height above. And Ahaz said, I'm not going to ask, nor will I put the Lord to the test. Of course, he didn't want to hear anything from God. Then he said, Isaiah said, now, hear now, O house of David. He's going beyond Ahaz, or Ahaz. Is it a small thing for you to weary men, but will you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord will give you a sign. Now, tell me if I'm wrong about this, Rabbi. That you in Hebrew is not the singular you. It's the plural you. Isaiah is talking far beyond King Ahaz. Now, let me just add one other fact to this equation. The fact is that oftentimes in Scripture, you have multiple fulfillments. The same prophecy might be used to deal with present time and might also be used to talk 600, 800 years in the future. God's word is so rich and deep, we shouldn't limit it to one fulfillment. Let me give you an example of this from Zechariah. He sits the high priest, Yeshua, down in a chair. And he says, take the silver and gold and make an elaborate crown and set it on the head of Joshua, or Yeshua, the high priest. And by the way, this was so unusual because high priests couldn't be kings. Kings couldn't be high priests. This had to be prophetic. And in fact, we know it is prophetic because it goes on to say, then speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, saying, behold, the man whose name is the branch. And now suddenly we're talking about Messiah, right? The man whose name is the branch, from his place he shall branch out and build the temple of the Lord. We know we're talking about Messiah. Yes, he will build a temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory. He shall sit on his throne, and he shall be a priest on the throne. In other words, when Messiah comes, he is going to introduce a new world order, because what he is going to do is unites the kinghood with the priesthood. He is going to be the one ultimate rosh, or head. Now, what does this mean? What it means is Zechariah, the book of Zechariah, is talking about the prophet Joshua, probably around the year 450.